We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I'm about to tune in now. Hello, my global viewers. How are you guys doing today? We are going to have a great show today. I'm super excited for our guest. Antwon Tanner is here. Woohoo! We're so excited to talk to him. He's working on many things, and we're going to dive into his life. Again, I have this platform because I wrote a book and I am an advocate for children in the entertainment industry. I'm a voice for them, and also I'm all about teaching the parents the different laws and everything that's out there so that they can be more aware of how the industry works so that they can have a great time and allow their kids to have fun in the entertainment industry. Also, I have this platform because I wanted to be able to talk to actors like Antwon that we know of, we've seen, we know him, we love all the work that he's done. He's a wonderful actor, but we don't always see him on, you know, Ellen DeGeneres or all these other big platforms and talk shows, and sometimes that's intentional. We'll find out if it is. Also, we have other people, and that's part of the business, whether it's the music industry, whether, like I said, social media entertainers that are entertaining people, and I want to be able to talk to them and see where their drive is coming from and give them a voice. Also today, I know I think I said also like three times. I'm going to change that word. But today I'm going to ask all my viewers to tag their favorite social media entertainer. So we have YouTube entertainers, snappers, who I think they're called snappers, that may snap and entertain through Snapchat. And we also have IG entertainers, who I watch a lot of them. I'm always entertained by especially a lot of comedians who go onto their social media and entertain us and make us laugh. I want you guys to tag your favorite social media entertainer so I can invite them to the show. I can interview them over the phone, and I can also have them come into the station. So go onto my page, Jackie Elam, Jackie.Elam on IG, and go under my show banner and tag your favorite social media entertainer. And I can also include you guys on the show as well. So whoever I choose, I will then find that tagger, and I can have you call in. You can send in a picture, and you can be part of the interview, part of the show, and we'll be able to see you. And you can ask your social media entertainer anything you want. I'm sure you could DM them, but I don't know if they may always reply. So this is a way to be part of a show that they're on. So hope that, you know, make everybody happy, because I want to be able to talk to my social media entertainers myself. And I know we all are entertained nowadays through the internet and through social media. It's not just through TV, through apps now. Not everyone is watching TV, and I'm just excited. So welcome, welcome, welcome. We have Antwon Tanner here. Hello, hello.
What up, what up, what up?
So, of course I know you. Like, when I watched, I know Coach Carter and Never Die Alone, and Black Jesus is mad funny. Like, oh, so funny. I find that show, I wish that it would come to network TV. I know it's a little raunchy for that and a little ratchet at times and a little provocative at times, but if they toned it down, I think it would be so funny on network TV.
It is. It's just, it's risky, because like, it's one of the projects that I actually, when I read the script, I was like, oh damn, what am I doing? But when I read it, I was like, oh, it's actually really good. It's funny, you know what I'm saying? It's hilarious, and we wilding out. But I like to choose projects like that, you know, because you have to pick and choose when you're doing stuff in your career. Mm-hmm. Everybody, I've been in the business so long now. It's like, a lot of actors, we know when you book a show, whether you just coming in to get a check for that one episode or whether you come in to get a check for a few seasons, you know what I'm saying? And Black Jesus was one of those that I looked at and was like, dang, you know what? I think this show could be around for a while. You know, Aaron Magruder's a really good producer, and Mike, and you know what I'm saying, with Slink and everybody over there, and with Corey Holcomb and Pops, and you know what I'm saying? It's, yes, like that whole, once they put everybody together, I was like, dang, I get to do a show with Charlie Murphy and all these people. You know what I'm saying? I was like, oh, yeah, I'm on. You know what I'm
and
saying?
And all the characters are so funny. I love it. And you can't be a super Christian. Like, if we have comedy and comedians, where did that come from? That gift and that talent comes from God. And we have to appreciate all that we have within. And I love it. Like, when I watched it, I wasn't offended. I find it to be extremely funny.
Yeah, but I think what it is basically like, you know, if people really read their Bible and stuff like that, you know, what they're basically doing is a satire. You know, where you have those people that's in church right now that was at the club last night kicking right. And then it'd be like, praise God. As soon as you walk away, it'd be like, I can't stand that heifer. You know what I'm saying? So it's like they basically talk about those type of people that you see every day, and they make the fun out of it. You know what I'm saying?
Yes. And so is it on Adult Swim? Because it is so like.
Yeah, well, I don't know. With Aaron, he has, you know, he created the Boondocks and all of that. So I think that's their niche. You know what I'm saying? Over there, you know, and all those guys are really clever at what they do to find the funny in the religion and stuff like that.
Oh, I love that. I love that. And for, again, people who may not have seen the show, it's on Adult Swim. It's called Black Jesus. I love it. I love the idea of just putting Jesus in the hood. And how would that be if Jesus lived in the hood, you know, and people like, that ain't Jesus, that's such and such, you know.
Yeah, but Jesus did live in the hood.
I mean, he was Bibles. Born in the manger, right? Like, you know, amongst the animals and all that other stuff. Yeah. And it's kind of dirty and all that other stuff. Oh, but I love the show, though. You said earlier you pick your shows based on just quality roles then, right? Like, you're trying to choose which ones would what represent yourself or your acting talent?
Well, I think what it is in this business, it's more of a challenge. You know what I'm saying? Like, most of the characters that I played early on when I was acting was really like myself. You know what I'm saying? I really had it really wasn't a reach for me. It was like character skills on One Tree Hill. That's me. You know what I'm saying? Drano in Sunset Park. That's me. That's who I was, you know what I'm saying? So once I start, you know, you try to find different roles where you could play. And you like, you know, that's the challenge. That's the satisfaction that you get out of trying to be somebody else. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, that's what we do for a living. You know what I'm saying? We want, this is a challenge for us to want to do this, to want to do that. You know what I'm saying? Just to give yourself that barrier that you could cross and then say, okay, I've done that. Now let me see if I could do this. You know what I'm saying?
But you were an athlete. Did you always want to act, or
I lucked up?
How? So tell me this. I read on it. I'm like, wait a minute. He was an All-American basketball player in high school, right?
Yep.
And you started in the industry around 1999.
No, actually, 94. Yeah, I was playing basketball at the Drew League, and this coach saw me play, and I was like real arrogant. You know what I'm saying? When I played, you know, but it was fun. I was like more entertaining. And the coach just liked the way I shoot. You know, everybody called me Drano. That was my nickname. Mm-hmm. And he, like, after the game, you know, he was just like, hey, I think you should come, you know, try out for this movie. I didn't have an agent or nothing, but one of my good friends, he was an actor. You know what I'm saying? I was just writing, doing music with him, you know, just in our spare time. But I was in college playing basketball. So it was like, I want to go to the NBA. I don't want to act. I ain't never took no classes. I thought you had to do all of that. And this guy, this coach, told me to just come to this tryout. So I go to the tryout. They was actors. They couldn't really play no basketball. So it was fun. You know what I'm saying? Right. And then he was like, they love you. They want you to come back tomorrow, but could you read this stuff? And I was like, oh, no. Mm-mm. I ain't no actor, bro. Y'all told me I was going to get $100 a day for being extra on one of the teams. Now my $100 a day about to go out the window. So, you know, I called my granny, rest in peace. And my granny was like, you know what? If you don't feel like you're going to get it anyway, you ain't got nothing to lose. So just go in and read it. And I was like, okay, but I ain't never acted. So this girl that I knew, her name is Becky Drury. She played basketball at Duarte High School. She's a good friend of mine. So I called her and was like, hey, Becky, I need your help. I need you to help me study these lines for tomorrow. I got this audition for this movie. And she was doing plays. And she was like, I got you, bro. It's nothing. So she came over and helped me study all that stuff. I had it word for word. And I didn't know, you know, because I'd never been to an audition in my life. I didn't know that you could use the paper in the audition.
Okay. So you thought you had to have that thing memorized.
Yeah, I'm just thinking you got to know it.
Well,
like,
how many pages? Was it a lot of lines to remember?
Yeah, it was probably about 4 pages.
Oh, okay. That's
but it was
a
just
nice
a
amount.
Yeah, it was just a conversation, but I had it like word for word. I thought you had to have the and the but and the for. I thought
you had to have everything.
But then I got in the room to audition, and I seen Danny DeVito and Rhea Perlman, and I got starstruck, and I was like, hey, my granny love you on Taxi. So I just got starstruck, and then she was like, okay, cool, that's fine. And I wasn't focused no more because I was so starstruck. Like, I wanted to take a picture with them. Right. I watched them growing up. And then she was like, okay, I'm going to read with you. And then when she read, I totally forgot all the words that I was supposed to do. So I just said them in my own words. And then when I left, I was like, well, I ain't get that. You know what I'm saying? I studied all night, man. I thought I just went in there and bombed. Oh, well, hopefully they'll still give me the $100 a day to play basketball.
That's all you were looking for. I need 100. And how old were you at that?
I was 18.
Okay. Okay.
And then,
because $100 a day for an 18-year-old is some money.
You know, I was good. And then I got to the house, and then my dad was like, some lady keep calling the phone talking about you need to call her. And I was like, for what? You know what I'm saying? He was like, something about some movie or something. I was like, oh, yeah, they probably calling to tell me that I bombed and don't come back. You know what I'm saying? Because I forgot everything I studied last night with Becky. You know what I'm saying? So he was like, so I end up calling the lady back, and she was like, congratulations, you booked the lead. And I was like,
wow.
What does that mean? Like, I had no idea because I'd never been in the business. So I was
the fact that, wait a minute, that's not how it normally works. It doesn't work where you get the phone call before you get home. You didn't even get home yet.
And I didn't have a car. So I called four buses. Oh. So it took me like 4 hours to get home. The audition was in Brentwood. I lived in El Monte. It was like I had to get
back. I'm like, wait a minute. That's a fast booking. But normally it's a callback. So you didn't have to do a callback. You went in the very first time you read, you booked it.
No, I had to audition for the basketball stuff.
That's right.
And then they had me come back to read.
Okay, but you didn't have lines for the basketball. It was just strictly basketball.
No, I just played basketball.
Oh, yeah. But technically that was your first audition. Because I feel like you did the lines on that one day and booked it. Wow.
Yeah, I was fortunate. But then, you know, after that, I had this agent, Bonnie Lakey. Love her to death. She, like, you know, gave me a shot in the business. And I just started, she started sending me out. And I started booking stuff. But most of the characters, like I said, was me. They wasn't too far reach. But then once I started getting paid to do this stuff, I was like, you know what, I can't disrespect the game. I really need to sit down and learn how to do this, because I was feeling inferior going in for certain characters, and I hear somebody in the room and they read that, I was like, damn, he was able to transform himself. Like, how did he do that? So took a lot in me to start studying to get my game right.
And so you started taking acting classes, or
I just started studying, you know what I'm saying, like studying people. I play basketball my whole life. So the thing is, the way I look at it is, if you are on a team, you're around 12 different characters every year that you play basketball. So a lot of times when you get an audition, you know somebody like that. Mm. So when you know somebody like that, you just go study them. Like, it's just like if you tell a story and you intimidate your girl, like, and she was up there, and you know what I'm saying? So it's like I would just take what my man would do and just use these words.
Okay.
So I would imitate him. Because art, you know, art imitates reality. Yes. So it's like that's what I would start doing. And when I really knew that I was good, or felt like I was crossing the barrier, when I did 413 Hope Street. And I played a Muslim character on 413 Hope Street.
Okay.
Damon Wayans produced the show, actually.
Okay.
Eric Lanville was the director and stuff like that. But it was a really good, it was a drama.
Okay.
With Richard Roundtree and Sherry Headley. Like, it was a big show. It was on Fox. But right before before Damon did My Wife and Kids.
Okay.
But he produced that show.
Oh, I didn't
really
know
good.
That.
A lot of people don't know that about Damon. Like, Damon is very talented.
Well, yeah, all of the Wayans are.
Yeah, he's very talented. And I played a Muslim on that show, and I killed this guy's son, Richard Roundtree's son, and then they dedicated this center to the son.
Okay.
And when I got out of jail, I never got caught for the murder. Okay. I got caught for drugs. But when I got out of jail, I was sent to this center, which it was abandoned when I killed him in front of the center.
Oh.
And then I end up meeting the dad. The dad, they never found the killer. And I end up telling the dad that I, you know, once I found out everything, that I killed his son. And I went to dinner with him and his wife and told him that I killed their son. But me and the dad got really close. It was a really good show.
Wow.
But it bought something different out of me.
Okay.
To where I was studying the Muslims. I
so
was
that going elevated
down
your,
yeah, so it
even
me.
Your desire to want to, like, really dive deeper into your different characters?
Yeah, you had to. I mean, because the thing is, I started working with big actors.
Okay.
And when you work with them, it was, like, intimidating.
Okay.
But I play basketball, so you're not supposed to never be intimidated about your opponent. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, I'm going to do me, you do you. So I had to get my swag back. And in order to get my swag back, I had to be prepared. You know what I'm saying? And they just basically taught me certain stuff. Like Charles Dutton said, slow it down, make it you. Okay. Denzel said, you know, real actors don't act, they be. Richard Roundtree told me, go with your instincts. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Sam Jackson said, forget the line, know the scene.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying? So I took all of those pieces that they gave me and just put it in one little thing, and that's what I live by. You
and
know what I'm saying?
You just picked that up pretty fast.
You have to, because when you're in the arena with Sam Jackson and he comes on set, you're not prepared. He is. Mm. You feel inferior. So it's like, nah, I'm going to be prepared too. You know what I'm saying? So then now it's.
They all challenged you.
All challenged.
So you worked with Denzel, Samuel Jackson.
I didn't never work with Denzel yet, but I was close.
But
I took information from him.
Wonderful. Yeah. Do you want to work with him one day?
Oh,
of course.
Yeah, definitely. I got close on a couple of his projects. I thought I booked it, but I was close.
Who else would you want to work with that you haven't?
I haven't worked with Charles Dutton, but I was close on a project with his where I got offered, but then something else happened. This was years ago. But, you know, I learned a lot from those guys. I would like to do something opposite Denzel, though. Mm-hmm. I think that would be good.
I think so, too. That would be great. Like, Sam, you worked with Sam. It's a family member in my boy's family. I don't have to say his name. But he stunt doubles for Samuel Jackson and has been his sole double for, like, the last 20 years.
Oh, dang.
If you worked with him, you probably met him. Yeah, you met him. But that's great. So you choose your characters very carefully, obviously. And so technically, it's like you're born with the gift then. Like, you thought it was basketball, but it really wasn't. Basketball allowed you to recognize different characters, like you say, to then help you in the acting career that God had set for you.
Yeah, I compare everything to basketball. You know, like, when you play basketball, practice starts at 3:00. At 2:55, you late.
Oh, okay.
You need to be at practice at 2:30, be warmed up, be ready to go at 3:00. You know what I'm saying? So it's, you know, your desire, like, make sure you're prepared to compete.
That's true.
And you have to be prepared to compete. Same thing with the acting business. You know, be on time for this. Don't, you know what I'm saying? Like, be unselfish in the game. You know, share information with other people if you can.
I feel like it's so much competition. People really do feel like if I share, if I give you this nugget, or if I tell you the inside secret to it, that I'm going to lose the job. I can't share. I feel like it's a lot of selfishness sometimes in this business. And I feel like people need to change the way that they look at it, because whatever is yours, it's already yours. Yeah, it's already yours. Nobody can take it from you.
If God got your name on it, it's yours.
It's already yours. Exactly.
I tell people that all the time. I say, hey, man, look, when I go to an audition, I might give Academy Award performance, but I might be too short. I might be too tall. I might be too light-skinned, too dark-skinned for the character, you know, because it's somebody else's vision. Whoever wrote it, they have in their mind what they want this character to look like. So they're going to try to get closest to whoever they can get to look like that and could play the part. I may be better at playing the part, but I may not look like that.
Right. So, again, if it is yours, it is yours. Nobody can take it from you. And that's why we need to open up all dialogue. And to be honest, even in the kid industry, you'll see the mama in the corner with the kid that's not letting the kid play with the other kids. I'm like, come on.
Yeah.
Hey, they're kids. Let the kid play. Like, we're all good. Like, all the kids are cute. It's not about who's cute. It's not about if your hair is curly or not. You just never know what the writer or the director or the producer is looking for. So many reasons why they book people. Mm-hmm. And again, your very first show was booked on a horrible audition in your mind. So you thought, and you still booked it.
They said he was really natural. And I was like, cool.
Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break. We are here with Antwon Tanner, diving into his life and his career. So be sure to stay tuned. Call in 323-473-3100 to ask him questions. And I know he has a lot of followers. And I see all the ladies on your social media. I mean, you're like, they are loving you. They love, love, love. And then he had the suit on with the banner. And they were like, oh, you look good. So call in. Y'all man is on my show. Hello. We'll be right back. Check it.
and host of LA Talk Live. Thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
This is Stephen Van Heflin, director of Dat Stone High Tech Learning Academy, inviting you to join us every Monday, 3 p.m. Pacific, for the We Are Code VR Tech Show. The We Are Code VR Tech Show is dedicated to growing a community of VR, virtual reality, and AR, augmented reality, developers in urban communities creating social solutions using virtual reality and educational engagement in mobile apps, website design, VR development, drone building and programming, robotics, 3D gaming. And we invite you to change the tech industry so there is more racial and gender diversity and inclusion. We also believe the We Are Code VR Tech Show on LA Talk Live can create creators and not just consumers of technology. So don't forget to tune in to the We Are Code VR Tech Show every Monday, 3 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, and now on Facebook Live. Watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasures. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Welcome back, global viewers. We are so excited to have Antwon Tana here, and he's just a natural. He was born to do this. It kind of fell into his lap a little bit from basketball, and we have a caller online right now. Welcome, caller. Who am I talking to, and where are you calling from? Hello, hello.
Hi, this is Jeff Daly.
Hi, Jeff Daly. How are you?
I am outstanding. I'm a first-time caller. Thank you for doing your show.
Oh, thank you for listening and watching.
Oh, no problem. And Antwon, I'm going to start out by saying I'm super impressed. I've never seen you do an interview, just know your work, and I love hearing all that goes into the successes that you have.
Oh, thank you, man. I appreciate the love.
Oh, no problem, no problem. Now, I will say, I did not book my first audition like you did, so I'm kind of coming from behind. But I would like to hear some inspiration for maybe some struggles you've had along the way. I know that every day you can't have the big win every day, and
yeah.
How maybe you got through that.
Yeah, well, you know, it was a big role that I wanted, you know what I'm saying? I got close on a bunch of stuff. It was like, man, I really wanted that one, but you don't get it, you know what I'm saying? But the thing is, in this business, you're going to get told, you know, 300 no's before you hear a yes. So the thing is, you just can't let it affect you, you know what I'm saying? Just make sure you focus your drive on something else, the way you can pay your bills. And, you know, that way you go into auditions not stressed. Like, you know, I don't want to go into this audition and my light bill is due. You know what I'm saying? Because then you're not able to relax and do what you do. You know what I'm saying? So just make sure you're able to take care of yourself first. Once you're able to take care of yourself, just always remember when you walk in that room, own the room and have fun. You know, because it is fun. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day. And my friend Westy Jonathan said his dad used to always say, once you find something you love to do, you'll never work another day in your life. And that's true. You know what I'm saying? So anytime I go into auditions, I'm having fun. It's like, oh, you know, if they like me, they like me. If they don't, they don't. And usually when you come out of that audition with that type of attitude, you would normally book it.
Because that's amazing.
It's funny, but you would normally book it when you go in there and you're not stressed because everybody else is going in there like, I got to get this role. I got to get this role. But when you go in there like, if I get it, I get it. If I don't, I don't.
So do you kind of go in like that, or are you kind of like reading over the lines? Are you pacing like some of them? Are you like in your zone? Because I see them. They're in the zone. They're in the corner. They're doing breathing exercises.
I don't do none of that. I just, you know, I look at it the night before.
Okay.
I put it down. Once I put it down, you know, a lot of people would trip you out with one thing. This is a lot of people's problem. They say they don't understand how to memorize.
Okay.
If you read something once and you put it down, you might tell me, you know what? I don't know it. I said, no, you do know it.
Okay.
And then I say, okay, what was it about? You will almost word for word verbatim tell me what that whole scene was about. So what do you mean you don't know it? You know it. You might not know the word for word at that time.
Right.
But you know what the scene is about. Now you go back and you touch it. You see what I'm saying? So you go back and you tighten it up. Now you go back and tighten it up and you just put those words. Basically, you make it you.
You see what I'm saying? So now you can
are
go
you
into that.
Are you visualizing it though? As you, so you, when you read it over the first time, you're kind of visualizing what's happening in the scene, the other characters involved.
Yeah.
And that helps you remember more.
Yeah, you just go over it one time. And you actually know it. It's the weirdest thing
It's
ever.
Not that easy. You're making it as... I think it's just your gift. It just has to be your gift and your talent.
If you read a book, but you didn't pay attention to every page or every chapter, I could ask you questions about a book. And you could go back through that book and say, oh, yeah, well, see, the book was basically... You could give me an overview.
Oh, right. A summary
so
of
you
it.
So you give you an overview. So okay. You basically know what it's about. Now you just go back and you just tighten it up. That's it. You know it already. You know what I'm saying? But that will help you relax to where when you walk into auditions...
I'm going to take that tip. I'm going to do, because, you know, I just started myself. I auditioned for commercials here and there. That's about it. But, you know, I don't know. I kind of put up not a lot of stress because I don't do that with my children. So it's so funny because I try to take the tips that I give them for myself. But I'm like, it's so different. But
yeah, commercials is different, though, anyway, from TV and film. Okay. It's night and day.
Have you done any commercials?
Yeah, I did one in, I think it was 97, the Da commercial, the Volkswagen commercial. Where we smelled a little stinky chair and we put it out to show how big the car was. That was it.
That's amazing. And so you've been going now since 94. 18 was the age. And I looked at IMDb. Your resume is pretty impressive. Like, so 94, that's 20 years. Like, we're over 20 years. Mm-hmm. And I only saw 1 or 2 years where I didn't see a gig on there. Like, you have worked every year of your career. That's except unusual.
That year, because I went back to school to get my degree.
Okay, good.
So that's why I took off, because it was hard to focus and work at the same time on school. So I just took off and I was playing basketball. So, you know, when you're playing basketball in college, it's, you know, your schedule is hard. You just like,
yeah,
you can't play basketball, go to class, study, and then try to be on the set. You know what I'm saying? It is too much.
We have a caller. Oh, yes. Is Jeff still on? Oh, that was a long answer. I thought he was. Jeff, I'm so sorry. You just breathed. Well, we can't even hear you breathing. I didn't even know. He's just part of the show now. Well, thank you so much, Jeff, for calling in. You got a long extended answer, but thank you so much.
I appreciate it.
Keep watching.
Thank you, sir.
I will.
I mean, I forgot about him, actually. He was just listening.
I was trying to make sure he was good.
Well, I think he has the answer for sure. Okay, so, yeah, so you've pretty much worked. I think that that's unusual because, you know, sometimes it's many years. That's why I wanted to ask, like, so it's really the art that you have now appreciated, mm-hmm. and have taken in. And I think if you're coming from that place, maybe that's why you're booking. What do you feel like you're doing different from other actors out there, especially actors that we know of, but we don't always see?
Well, what it is everything you read is tomato, tomato. What you have to look at it is what's going to make you different in that room.
Okay.
When I auditioned for Never Die Alone, that scene that I had with DMX, everybody was in the room yelling, you know, like, hey, homie, dude, this is it. So me, I was always told the quiet ones are the more crazier ones.
Oh, yeah. I've heard
so that. I'm not going to do what they do. I'm going to go in this room and I'm going to approach this scene different. Okay. I'm going to be more eyes on, real quiet, like, listen to me. You know what I'm saying? And demand that attention to where now I'm scarier than the dude who's yelling.
Right.
Because you don't know what to expect from me. Okay. So I did it the opposite. I looked at it, you know, tomato, tomato. And when I left, DMX was like,
him.
He did that.
So you stood out from that. But when you audition, you don't see other people's auditions.
But sometimes you could hear them in the room if you're in the hallway.
That's true.
So it's
I do tell my boys, pay attention, listen.
Yeah, you can hear them in the hallway. You know, but I usually don't let that bother me. You make your choice and you stick with it, mm-hmm. period. You know, because if the director wants something else, then they'll ask you, okay, can you do it this way?
Okay.
And then if you do it that way, then that shows that you have range.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying? So it works both ways.
And so you have to also be able to be flexible in this business and don't take it personal. You didn't do anything wrong. They may want to see it a different way.
Exactly.
We have a caller on the line. Hello, caller. Welcome to Jackie Elam Live. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Hi, my name is Kia. I'm actually from Houston. You're on the phone with your sister.
H-Town.
Hi, I just had a quick question because I know you back from like Moesha and, you know, Coach Carter. And I heard you mention that you actually was playing basketball. So how was it working with Samuel L. Jackson? Because, you know, he's a character.
Man, Sam is, that's Uncle Sammy. You know what I'm saying? He's like, working with Sam, is it was so cool. I'm going to tell you, it's a lot of superstars out here that act like superstars.
Okay.
Sam don't act like that.
Oh.
And I'll tell you one quick story what happened on the set. And I never forget this. Never forget this. We were about to go to lunch one day. And we was working with these extras every day because, you know, we filming basketball scenes. So it's like 400 extras on the show. Mm-hmm. And at lunch, it was kind of, they had it like segregated. They had this police caution tape up. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is where the extras sit. This is where the actors and producers sit. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? And Sam walked in and he was like, what the hell? Did somebody get killed? Like, that's what he said. He said, somebody get killed? Sam went and took that caution tape down.
Oh.
And was like, if we work together, we eat together. What? Why they ain't got no ice over there for
that's
the extras?
Dope.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he was hot. Like, why they don't have no ice for the extras?
Okay.
That's so admirable for somebody of his status.
Exactly.
To do that. You know what I'm saying? And he knew everybody by name. Every day that we work with these people, like, Sam is a genuine character, man. I love that dude.
And then I read that. Thank you so much, Kia from Houston, for calling in. Did you have another question?
Oh, no problem. Thank you. I just had that quick question. You guys have a good one.
Thank you,
too.
Mama.
Thank you so much for calling in. I know we're going to get more callers than usual because you're on. But you were saying that I read that he is the reason why you got into acting. Sam is.
Yeah, well, you know, because I was a fan of his from years ago. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was like, if I model my career after anybody, because I just love that Gator character that he did. That character was, I was like, oh my God, that he was so funny to me. He got the little dancing thing and everything. And he actually told us the story on how he did it. He said he was fresh out the rehab. He was late for work and the security wouldn't let him on the set. Spike was looking for him.
Okay.
And the security was like, hey man, homeless dude, get away from the set, homie. And so he was like, he was trying to get on the set for like hours. And he was like, man, look, see, this is what happens when you give an addict the chance. They don't show up on time. But he had been literally trying to get on set for an hour. But he was fresh out the rehab.
So he
really looked like that, like Gator. He was really Gator.
You know? Right.
But when Spike went to the gate and saw him, was like, hey, man, get over here. And so the security was like, oh, I was trying to keep him away from the set. I thought he was like soliciting.
Oh, that is hilarious.
So, you know, so it was crazy. But I was like, wow. But, you know, he told us that story. I was like, that's crazy. But, yeah, he definitely motivates me a lot because I see all the different characters that he play. He dives into them. And like I said, when you on set, I just steal from them all the time. I just sit back and I just be in awe. But I still have to do my thing, you know, without them knowing. But I observe a lot, you know what I'm saying? And just observing how he took his beats and made this character likable and, you know, and shaded it. And you just like, wow, like, damn, I'm going to do that. You know what I'm saying? So I think one day I'm going to be able to get to that point.
Wow, that's great. So it's definitely you that's booking the jobs. Is having good representation part of it, like actually being able to get in front of these auditions, and or do you get a lot of your shows now from direct booking now?
Well, I've been working a lot now, so it's like a lot of people, they know me. You know what I'm saying? It's a catch 22 because sometimes, like, it was a time when I wasn't working at all, and people
but
was
not
just,
according to your IMDb.
Yeah, but I'm saying I was. Me being out of work for 4 months is a long time for me.
You guys don't understand. This is unusual. That's unusual.
Yeah, that's a long
it
time.
It takes sometimes, you know, you'll see somebody, some years go by, you see somebody, but you have consistently worked. It's a blessing.
And the thing is, a lot of casting directors that know you, they'd be like, oh, he's not available. They get tired of calling and just hearing he's not available till one time. Like, even for Black Jesus, they thought I wasn't available, and knew somebody who called in and was like, would y'all see Antwon Tanner? She was like, we was looking for him. He's available.
Oh.
She was like, yeah, we was going to offer it to him. We wouldn't even going to have auditions. I was like, oh, cool. I was like, thank you.
Did you have to audition for Black Jesus or no?
Yeah, I went in and auditioned. But Amber Bickham, she's really cool. She was actually a fan of mine. That's what's crazy. She sent me a picture one day that I posted on my Instagram of, she said, I was so in love with you back in the day when you did Sunset Park, and it was at a charity game.
Okay.
And I took a picture with her, and she still had that picture.
Oh.
And she's a casting director now.
So. And see, that's a good tip. You never know who you're taking pictures with, actors, you know, and musicians.
You got to treat entertainers. Everybody good.
Exactly.
You got to treat them good.
Because you never know where your next job will come from and who will put in a good word for you.
Everybody that start at the bottom, that's not where they want to stay.
Exactly.
So you never know what they want to do. Some people start at the bottom just to learn every job on the way up and could be your boss one day. Like on Black Jesus, one of the producers of the show, Megan, is my boss.
Right.
But she was an assistant on Coach Carter.
Oh.
You see, she was one of the producer's assistant.
So and that's if you treated her bad or something, and she would have been like, I'm not hiring him. Yeah, she'll remember. It's a small community, mm-hmm. and your reputation is everything in the business.
Yeah, I know PAs that's directors now. You know what I'm saying? That was my PA, Mark. He was a PA on Sunset Park, and he's directing a lot of movies, HBO, Showtime. Like, he's doing a whole lot. But I used to watch certain actors treat them dudes bad, and I'd be like, nah, dude, don't trip. I'm going to go get my own pancakes. You know what I'm saying? And he'd be like, nah, this is my job. Let me go get it. You go to hair and makeup. Okay. I ain't got no hair, and I don't wear no makeup, so I can go get my pancakes.
I just want my pancakes and my syrup.
I can get that pancakes real quick. Don't trip, Mark. I got it. But they remember that because you find yourself, a lot of stuff that I worked on was people just call like, yeah, you booked this. And I'm like, I didn't audition for that. My agent's like, well, somebody, one of the producers knew you and he knew your work. So you just, you know, you lead them all. You going to Utah to film this. I'm like, really?
Oh, I love that.
Cool. Tell them thanks. You know what I'm saying? But they remember what you do on set.
And it's a small circle. And so they talk. And so if you're the butthole on the show, they're going to tell their friends, too.
Yeah, they'll know.
Don't work with this person because he mm-hmm. was a butthole.
Yeah, they'll know.
And you have to appreciate it because we all start somewhere.
Yeah.
And you don't know where a person will end up. So you want to treat everybody like you want to be treated. Very, very, very simple morals. Just very simple.
You have to.
But a lot of people, I don't know if it's just the fame or the attention that they never had before. They began to change maybe. And you've been humbled, obviously, throughout your entire career. The same consistent.
I mean, I lucked up in the business, so I'm just happy to be here. You know what I'm saying? And then my granny always told me, you know, you treat everybody the same.
Exactly.
You know, you ain't better than nobody. You just got a better job.
That's right.
That's it. You make a little bit more money than they do. And you might be a little bit more known than they are, but that don't make you better than them.
And you said, no, because we know you. Like, when you start, especially so many movies and shows you've done, especially One Tree Hill. Now, I want to say, like I said earlier, I've never watched that show. Forgive me. I've never seen One Tree Hill. And you were, like, the token Black person on there. And I don't know if it was maybe geared towards teenagers at the time. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's teenage.
So I just never caught it. But you have diehard fans from that show. OTH, OTH. I'm surprised y'all don't have, like, little signs for OTH. OTH.
Yeah, they got it. We still doing conventions. Like, the show's been off the air for, like, four years.
I read that since 2012.
And convention, we're supposed to go to Paris in a couple of weeks, and they just had to postpone the convention till January. But we have another one in Chicago in November. And these conventions, they do 1,000, 1,500 people show up to these conventions.
Is this show being aired in other countries? And is that
yes,
why?
Yes, it's really big overseas.
There you go. Because I'm like, I'm confused. I need to know what's happening. Why are they still like following? Oh, so it's still being aired.
We're superstars over there. Overseas, we have a huge following overseas. All in the UK, London. I mean, you name it over there. Australia, Italy. Huge followings over there for One Tree Hill. But, I mean, we have Netflix to thank for that, because the thing is, we have 9 seasons.
Okay.
And so when people, like even younger kids now, they go on Netflix and then they binge watch it.
Okay.
So we get new fans every day, because like it's fans on there that be asking me questions. I'm like, wait,
I don't remember this.
You're 16. When we did this show, you were 2. Like, there's no way you could watch the show. You know what I'm saying? But they watch it.
Okay.
They watch the show die hard. But you know what? It's a really good show. So the thing is, if you start watching it, I guarantee you'll binge watch it.
I need to go, because I'm like, I hope you don't feel offended, but I mean, that was 4 years ago, and in America, you know, that's like a long time ago, because they're not airing it maybe on, you know, certain stations, but it's on Netflix now. Mm-hmm. I will go binge watch it now. But I saw the other stuff, and I definitely saw Black Jesus. That is my show.
See, you watched the Black stuff.
No, that is not true. Okay, I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is when I, you know, like an all-white show, you got the one token, you know, those I'll be like, oh, okay, you got the one little black person in there. Like, I don't know.
But again, it was more blacks on the show. It was more blacks on the show. It's just
so.
You know.
And then if it just ended 4 years ago, were you hired to play way younger?
Yeah, your I character? Was on the show. I would think I was like 21 when we started filming, but we all was like playing like 16.
Oh, so like 5 years younger. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so we all was 16, but then as the show went to like season four, then what they did was they jumped ahead. They went ahead five years, so we were all grown. So we were all adults to where now we could drink, we could go to the bar, so it made sense to have a cocktail, you know what I'm saying, like.
See, that's the magic of TV. You can grow up really fast on it. We're going to take a quick break. We're having great conversation. I have more questions. Please call in 323-473-3100 with any questions that you may have for Antwon. He's here. He's young looking. And I don't see a ring on his finger. Well, I'll be asking that question later, too.
Okay.
Tune in. Watch.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome. This is Greg inviting you to tune in Saturday, 6 p.m. to the Mystic Ballroom. All vinyl most of the time, and we'll cover psychedelic, soul, garage, and much, much more. Myself and the Young Mogul, we're bringing you this every Saturday at 6 p.m. exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, Live 365 Radio, Flag, TuneIn Radio, AHA Radio, TV Radio, and Apple TV Radio. Or you can watch, listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality Radio, handcrafted for yours and mine, listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
I'm about to tune in now.
Welcome back, my global viewers. Right before the break, I was saying maybe possibly he's single, but I just found out he's not. So hopefully I didn't get him in trouble because he don't have his ring on. Beyonce put a ring on it. He's supposed to put a ring on your finger too.
I wear mine.
Okay, so he is married, so you cannot call in for his number, guys.
Don't get me stabbed.
No, don't get him in trouble. And hello, wife, if you're watching. So right before we went to break, I had a question in my head. So what else do you want to do in the business that you haven't done? We know you're an actor. Do you want to produce, write?
I'm already producing and writing. I produce Crew, the movie that we did that's on Netflix. Actually, it's called CRU.
Okay.
So we did that. I wrote a pilot that I'm probably shoot like in April or May.
Okay.
Called Epidemic. It's about an HIV clinic.
Okay.
Kind of like a Grey's Anatomy meets like Crash.
Oh, that's different though.
You know.
And so it's in a HIV clinic. Oh, that'd be some drama and some real. Oh, that's good. That's different. That's good.
I wrote a movie that I'm not done with. It's called Innocent Killers.
Okay.
So, you know, about the judicial system and the death penalty. So,
okay.
Working on some stuff, you know, raising some funds so I could start, you know, doing that. But I directed a movie called Crush. And, you know, I'm getting on that other side a little bit to be able to produce stuff and bring, you know, get rid of some of these whack reality shows that we watching on TV. Like,
so if you didn't watch the show last week, we had a president of Cinema in, and she was explaining the reason why we see so much reality TV is because it's just cheaper.
It's cheaper to shoot it, and people watch it. So, you know, it's cheap to shoot it. They make a ton of money. So, I mean, from a producer standpoint, why not?
Mm-hmm.
If people going to keep watching the Kardashians, they tune in, we going to keep shooting the Kardashians. That's what I would do. You know what I'm saying? It ain't my cup of tea, but.
Yeah, mine either. I stopped several seasons ago.
Yeah, it's not my cup of tea, but to each his own. They like it, I love it.
Right. And so, yeah, you've been in it for so long to where is that a natural transition? Do you think most actors, if they're in the game for a minute, they eventually another door is open or not? Do you think they're comfortable with just being an actor, or do we all have that inside that want to grow and like go to a higher level and challenge ourselves on a different level?
Well, I think that as much as I work, you know what I'm saying? I was a series regular on the show for 9 years. So you work every day, you know what I'm saying? So when you work every day, you start getting the creative juices flowing and you start seeing stuff. It's like, oh, okay, I know how to do this. I could do that. Oh, you know what? Maybe I'll direct the episode, or maybe I'll try to write an episode. You fall into it and you kind of already know what you're doing. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, dang, you know, I've been doing it on this side of the camera. So it's like, nobody got to tell me how to be blocked. Nobody got to tell me this. And then you have directors that'll come up and ask you questions like, can you give me this? And then you always go back to the director like, I think that this character should do this. And I feel like I should move around. I feel like I should do, you know what I'm saying? So as you're doing that, you're actually directing.
Directing, exactly.
You're actually directing. So why not get the extra check? And the check is like 3 times as much as what the actors get.
Oh, okay. So but they don't get residuals, though.
No, they do, too.
Directors get residuals?
Mm-hmm.
Producers?
Yes.
Oh, I always thought it was stunt performers and actors. Mm. I love learning. Mm. Okay.
You get money.
Oh, that's great then. And that's wonderful. Yeah, that's
they stay
wonderful.
With the check.
And so do you have to have different representation when you're now, because, you know, you have the Writers Guild, you have the Screen Actors Guild, yep. and After Guild. Mm-hmm. So you have to get, you have the same representation, but you also have to join that guild and
you
do all that.
You got to join that guild.
And then Directors Guild.
Yep.
Do they have a Producers Guild?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. Okay. Oh. Yep.
You got to join them all.
Oh, so that's like 4 different pensions.
Four different set of dudes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's so true. So, but you're always working. You have no problem. You're always working.
Yeah, they
working.
Take a little percentage of it. You know what I'm saying? But it is what it is. It's part of the game. But they protect you, too. So, you know, that's good.
So what are you doing outside of the industry that you would want your followers to know about you that they don't know?
Well, right now, I start my... I think this is my 4th season with the Orange County Nova Stars. I play professional basketball still.
Oh.
But our season starts November 4th. And okay. And so right now I'm just training for that. I have my own company. I started a company called Greenhouse Therapies. Medical marijuana out here is like really big and it makes a lot of money. And it's like
I've never
smoked in my life, but on the medical side, when you look at it, you're like, hey, this is a good investment.
Yeah.
So I invested in that, you know what I'm saying? So I got that going on. I run that business every day and, you know, about to branch out and go, you know, commercial and stuff like that to get to the next level, because the business makes a lot of money and I could take that money and start funding projects that I want to shoot instead of meeting with investors who just want to meet.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? That's L.A.
Right.
Everybody want to meet.
Oh, you having meetings. Yeah, no.
Everybody want to meet.
I
don't want to meet.
What's a business
no
meeting?
Yeah, I don't want to meet. I'm tired of taking people to lunch. But just to take them to lunch.
It's a write-off, though.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay, so with Kim Kardashian just getting robbed, you know, we've had, you know, I know Kanye has been robbed. We've heard about Drake, you know, we've heard about Chris Brown. You have all these celebrities that... either somebody's stealing from them or trying to plot. Do you ever have any concerns? Do you think it's the crew that they have around them? Do you normally think it's an inside job? Do you have any concerns about someone robbing you as an actor? You are the face of a lot of your shows that you're on.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's the circles you keep. You know okay. what I'm saying? Like, I'm from Chicago. I'm a hood dude, period.
Oh, so they probably don't want to mess with you, just to begin.
You know what I'm saying? And the thing is, I think, when you move a certain way and you create so much attention, you give people a chance, an opportunity to pay attention to what you're doing. I don't post a lot on social media. I just got out the shower. I'm about to eat some eggs. I'm about to go out of town for the next 2 weeks. Your house could get robbed doing that. That's snitching. Yeah, I grew up, said snitches get stitches. I'll post it when I get back.
Right.
This was my trip in Paris. Nobody knew I was gone.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And I think it's the circles that they keep. A lot of times when I go places, I might be in the hood and slosh a swap meet or something. And by the time I walk through to go get what I'm getting and I get out, somebody might recognize you. And you like, but it might be other people that recognize you and don't say nothing because they like, nah, that ain't him.
Okay.
But by that time they realize it's you, you gone.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So they're like, wait, I think I saw a dude. You know what I'm saying? You keep it pushing. So they don't have a chance to plot. because they don't, you know what I'm saying? It depends on how you move. You have to move different being born in Chicago.
Okay.
You have to be observant being born in Chicago.
But Kanye is from Chicago and he got robbed. But you said it could have been the inside job.
But Kanye was
boasting.
Kanye was from the hood, but he wasn't part of. Kanye wasn't no get down like that.
Oh, okay.
He wasn't no. I was out there. You know what I'm saying? I was in the gangs. I was out there. You know what I'm saying? So you roll different when you move different than, you know, cats on the block. They weren't trying to get that kind. They like, oh, that's the little dude. He going to school. He do. You know what I'm saying? You live on the block, but they ain't really, you know, about you. You ain't on that.
Yeah.
But when you part of the hood, it's a little bit different.
Do you think it's part of it? It's the boasting, though. Like if I just got this diamond earring, this, I'm always showing. They're always sometimes showing all of their money sometimes, and you know, there's a lot of people out here struggling, and maybe they just want to get part of it.
It's a hating mentality. You know, I feel like everybody was offered the same tools. You know, you learn the same rules growing up in these houses. And, you know, I knew that the stove was hot and the refrigerator was cold. You know, you learn that at 5 or 6. Don't right. touch that. Don't do this. It's just some people don't. Everybody feel like you owe them something okay. when you come from certain, you know, it's a mentality. A lot of people feel like, oh, because you doing what you doing. It's like, no. When you were skipping school and I was in the library studying for that test, I couldn't party.
Right.
But now that all my studying and everything done paid off for me and your life ain't turned out the way you wanted to, that's because of those are the choices that you made. So because I could enjoy the fruits of my labor, I should be able to do that without you having to say I owe you something because I came from the same neighborhood as you. We had the same opportunity. You just didn't take advantage of what you should have took advantage of, mm-hmm. period.
That's true.
You know. But with them, you know, like I do, they do boast a little bit about what they got. I'm not flashy. But like I said, I'm part of the
hood. But are you concerned? Because I feel like it could be from the inside job. It could be the boasting. But, you know, with a gun to your head, you know, I feel like, okay, that didn't take it to a whole other level. We got the crazy guy that's always on red carpets kissing Will Smith in the mouth or, kissing Kim Kardashian's butt and picked up, you know, the little Gigi Hadid girl.
Yeah.
So, you know, I know if he came across you, you probably hit him with a hook or something.
But I'm just saying a lot of those people, they get caught up in the limelight and they're not observing. You know what I'm saying? They're not observing. It's the way you observe certain situations. It's like if I go to my cousin Kiki house and I know he a gang member, 9 times out of 10, I know what's going on over there.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? So what's the likelihood of it being a drive-by? Very high. But if I'm at Tyler Perry or Oprah Winfrey house, what's the likelihood of a drive-by happening over there? It's not.
Unlikely,
it's the company
right.
you keep, the way you move. You know what I'm saying? You surrounded by 9 broke dudes, you're bound to be the 10th. It's
right.
the company that you keep. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just move different. That's
okay.
all. You know, I just think they boast and brag a little bit too much, and cats just, they get at them. But when you more humble, cats don't never know what you got.
Exactly.
So when they don't know what you got, a lot of times
you can
move, you know,
freer.
And I think it's a difference in the type of fans that you have.
Okay.
NBA players have a different type of fan. They have the girls who go, "Oh my God, I love you," because they see his contract on TV every week. You know
yeah.
what I'm saying? When you're a rapper, you got people constantly reaching to the stage. They can never touch you. So, you know what I'm saying? So they're in love with that image. With actors, they see us every day on TV. So they feel like we're more personable to talk to and approach because they feel like they know you.
Exactly. That's
true. You know what I'm saying? So my fans don't come off and go, "Oh my God, it's you." Like they would a 50 Cent or a Drake or, you know what I'm saying? So I don't have that crazy rush. I have the more, "Hey dog, what's good, man? Hey, I love your work, man. You doing your thing." So even the hardest of the hardest gangsters approach you like that. "Keep doing your thing, my boy. I really Just at the DMV, I was with my son yesterday, and the dude yelled out the window, "Hey, man, keep doing your thing, homie." And I was like, "Hey, appreciate it, brother." I kept walking, but it's a different love that they have for actors
okay.
than they do for basketball players or, you know, whether you're an athlete or a rapper. And everybody you name that got robbed, they
yeah.
have that paparazzi type of fame.
They do. They
do. You can't name one actor that
so
just got robbed.
You intentionally, you're seen... But in the background, but known, but you're not like purposely like trying to just do the whole paparazzi in the limelight all the time. Like that's planned. Is that because you have a family, you think?
I mean,
because
no,
you're married with kids, or that's just who you are?
It just that's what it comes with the territory. It's just that's what actors fans are. Because, I mean, a lot of people know Sam Jackson. A lot of people know Denzel. But they see Denzel at basketball games. They're like, hey, what's up, Denzel? How you doing, man? It ain't that. You know what I'm saying? But you see a rapper, it's like, he think he got it because he throw 50,000 at the strip club. And move. You know what I'm saying? So it's constant competition because that's your persona. People believe your image when you are an athlete or you are this. When they see you outside of that, because all they know is money. When you're a basketball player, all they see is, oh, he worth $184 million. He got two shoes out. Okay. You see what I'm saying? But they don't never say that about actors. They don't know what That's we true. Make. They just feel like you're more personable to approach.
That is true. You don't know. We never know what your contract is.
Yeah, your contract ain't on unless you Will Smith, where they know you're making $30 million a movie. You know what I'm saying? That's usually it. All the rest of the actors, you have no idea what they're making.
That is so true. You don't.
And that's why you do white shows, because you can make $1 million a year.
And you never know.
Got to negotiate.
So it's good to be the token black person on a white show.
Yes,
it's really good.
I need another job like that right now.
I know, right? We need a friends around here. Good show going on. Great money. Yeah. So, yeah, that's amazing. And that's good, though. I figured it was more of the personality of the actor that causes that attention, because we will attract what we are. And if you are boastful and if you are flashy and you want to be seen, then you're going to be on the scene. Mm-hmm. So have you ever sat down on like a talk show type of arena to like get interviewed? Do you ever do like the Ellen DeGeneres type of shows, or you just stay away? Because I know One Tree Hill, it was a hit. So
we've been on MTV and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? But they don't call you on their show. So when they don't call you, you don't go. Our whole thing is, you know, in this business, a lot of times, you know, the game done changed so much now.
Yes.
So the thing is, in this business, just keep working. And when you keep working and the fruits of that labor pay off, it's just going to pay off. You know, let them come to you. You know what I'm saying? As long as you keep a job. That's really what it's about. It's really about doing what you want to do, having fun at doing what you want to do, getting paid to do what you love, and, you know, just experiencing these different characters that you could play. You know what I'm saying? Because with acting, it's not like basketball. It's not like rapping, where you could fizzle out. If you're talented, you could act till you die.
Yes,
you know what I'm saying? You
could
play all
kind
of characters, you know, from here to from childhood on. You know what I'm saying? So it's just staying fresh and studying your craft and just making sure that you're out there to do what you're supposed to do.
So then you take pride in having a separate life then? Like, you do you do it intentional, though? Like, are you more prone to separate the two? Like, your family life is here and then your career is over there?
Yeah, because, you know, none of my kids is actors or nothing like that.
Okay, that was going to be my next question. So you're married, and how many kids do you have?
Four.
Oh, you have four kids? Mm-hmm. Okay, awesome. You look so young. I mean, I know you get that a lot.
Yeah, my daughters are 23, 21.
23?
And my sons are 20 and 15.
Oh, okay. Wow. Black don't crack.
Yes.
It's really true. I mean, you know, guys, we're friendlier with the son. But that's amazing. I didn't mean to say that. Yes, I did. So your wife, is she in the business?
Nope. None of my kids ain't nothing.
They don't have the desire. Okay, because you've done a great job. You have amazing fans that are still with you from day one, and they just don't have the desire at all to do it. They've never asked at all.
My daughter asked one time, and then she didn't follow through. So
are they more athletic then? Did they take that from you?
Yeah, my sons are athletes. Okay. My daughters are just cute girls.
And that's all they have to be. And yeah, daddy's little girls.
So they do what they do.
That's wonderful. If they ever came to you, though, at a later age and say that they wanted to do it, like maybe your younger kids, would you advise them to? Would you want them to?
I mean, if that's what they want to do, I support it. You know what I'm saying? Whatever they want to do, I support it. And because, you know, growing up, a lot of times that's what a lot of kids miss, that support. You know, like even if my son, it was a point in time where he wasn't getting hardly no minutes, but I didn't miss a game.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like just you being there, that support. It's different for them because I didn't have it a lot of times, you know, growing up. Like, my mom probably seen me play once. But she got every trophy that I ever earned.
I love that. So family support. And family is really big, obviously, for you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You got to have that.
That's wonderful. And how long have you been married?
10 years.
Okay, that's great. That's great, especially in this business.
Well, 11 years, actually. Don't get me stabbed. 11.
That's wonderful. So, is there another season of Black Jesus?
Yes, we don't start filming until January, though.
Okay, because I was wondering. I'm like, please let this show come back.
Oh, yeah, I think like that show is going to be around. I think that they're rewriting a lot of stuff right now to make this season like one of those seasons, because it's that season where this is a pivotal season for us, because if the show comes out and it's still number one like it's been, then they'll probably buy 60 more episodes. So it'd be on the air for another 5 years. You know what I'm saying? So I think they just making sure we got 10 hot scripts to go do and go and get this syndication money.
So it's 10 shows per season, yep, for Black Jesus. And you guys can catch that on Adult Swim. It is hilarious. It's my new favorite show. And I'm kind of mad because I watch TV through the apps. And the last season, they give me the first few and then the last few. But the ones in the middle, I'm like, oh, I can't get it on the app.
You got to go to Hulu. You have to,
so I need to do it through Hulu. This was very quick. I need to stop saying that, but this 1 hour does go by fast.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
thank,
yeah,
you so much for coming in. We
thank
learned
you
a
for
lot.
Having me. Thank
we
you,
learned
thank
a lot.
You.
And the obvious reason, honestly, for you working, it's just, it's your gift, it's your talent. That's what your calling is. That's what you were put on this earth to do. And so thank you for contributing to the world of acting.
Oh, thank you
we
so much.
We all love
your
work.
Thank
continue
you.
Continue to be humble as you are, which I know you will be. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. I'm Jackie Elam. This is Jackie Elam Live. Oh, I didn't even introduce my name earlier. I guess they figured that out, huh? I eventually knew I was going to stop saying I'm Jackie Elam. Like, duh, it's Jackie Elam Live. So don't forget, everyone, tag your social media entertainer, and I will choose you and that social media entertainer to interview on my show. If there are any local social media entertainers, I will have them come in. I can also interview your social media entertainer over the phone, put pictures, even put some videos on of whatever comedy skit they're doing. I can add you onto the show, you the tagger as well, to talk to your favorite social media entertainer. So thank you so much for tuning in. We had Antwon Tanner here, very humbled actor, now producer, writer, and watch out for all his shows that he will be working on. And they already know your social media, but you want to shout out your social media?
Follow me on Twitter at Antwon_Tanner or on Instagram at AntwonTanner2214.
Awesome. Got it? Awesome. We'll see you guys next week, Saturday from 12 to 1. Thank you so much for watching. Have a great day.
Have a great
Saturday. There go. It's the Jackie Elam Show.
Three, two,
I'm about to tune it now.
She gives the voice to the voiceless.
I'm about to tune it now.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.